In this module, we're going to look at the neuroscience of resonant versus dissonant leadership. In the earlier modules, we talked about how effective leaders who bring out the best in us engage in this in-tune relationship. They're creating the experience of hope, mindfulness, and compassion. Well, 2 years ago, and just published this year, with colleagues at the Cleveland Clinic, with doctors Mike Phillips, Jamie Stoller, Mark Lowe, Catherine Koenig, and Blessie Matthews, and Angela Passarelli in our doctoral program, we did a study of executives that came out in Leadership Quarterly of the neural activation of others, followers, in response to resonant versus dissonant leaders in their lives. So we interviewed these average age 49-year-old executives about moments in their lives with resonant leaders and dissonant leaders. We extracted from the interviews six specific episodes, six moments that each of them had with a resonant leader and six moments with a dissonant leader. A number of weeks later, they came back and went through a fMRI, a functional magnetic resonance imaging machine, in which we repeated back to them. Actually, it was Angela Passarelli who did the interviews, repeated back these specific moments and asked them to react to how they remembered the leader, his or her style, his or her effectiveness, the impact they had on them. When we put all of that data together, we found a number of dramatic differences that help us to understand not just the feelings that resonant leaders versus dissonant leaders create, but also what goes on in their brains. One of the things that was dramatic is the activation of the mirror neuron networks. Now, a number of years ago, several neuroscientists, in particular one Dr. Iacoboni and one Dr. Rizzolatti, had talked about, in the 90s, mirror neurons and mirror neuron networks. By now, a number of years later, people have reassured and supported their original findings that these networks in the brain, these parts of the neural network, allow us to mimic the actions of others. Now, there are some mirror neurons in the brain, but mostly it's the mirror neuron networks that help us do this. And since then, others have found, like Jean DeCetti and Don Bateson, have found what they call hemodynamic sympathetic networks that allow us to activate directly in our brains something that tunes us into another's emotions. Between these two networks, we can tune into others at a neural level, at a direct brain level. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Little bit of science fiction? It seems that way. But the thing that's worth remembering is that these activations occur in milliseconds, and they last for a very long time. So they occur predominantly below consciousness. Well, one of the things we found is that in response to these memories of resonant leaders in their lives, the executives activated the mirror neuron networks. And when they were exposed to these moments that they had with dissonant leaders, they deactivated these same networks, which is to say they were suppressed. Second finding, I have to go back and explain something that Professor Tony Jack here at Case Western Reserve University has just published an article in Neuroimage showing that when we are given an analytic task, we're given something that requires analysis, numbers, finance, physics, these kinds of analytic tasks, we activate a network in our brain called the task positive network. It is a part of the executive function. This is the part of our brain that enables us to focus and solve a problem. But the task positive network in our focusing also blocks out other possibilities and, in fact, ignores certain things. What Tony Jack showed in this masterful study was that when we are given social situations to deal with, somebody arguing with someone, someone asking someone for a favor, someone trying to appeal to someone else, we activate a different network and circuits in our brain, and he called it the social network, which is a component of the default mode network. Now, people have kind of known for a while these two networks were going on. What Tony showed is that these two networks are almost completely independent. They have very little overlap, and they suppress each other. Yes, that's right. So when you go into analytic mode, when you're focusing on problem solving, you're suppressing the social mode. And when you go into the social mode, you're suppressing the analytic mode. Now, the fact is that we need both. You need to be able to focus and make decisions and solve problems. And we need the social network, not just to deal with people, but also to deal with emotions, moral configurations around social issues, and to be open. Because it's in the default mode network and the social network that we're open to new ideas. Well, in our study, it was very clear that the moments, recalling moments with resonant leaders activated the parts of the social network in the default mode network. And that when people reacted to moments with dissonant leaders, they were about a third of the time activating these social default mode networks, but two thirds of the time they were suppressing them. We also showed that reactions remembering, recalling these moments with the resonant leaders led to more activation of parts of the brain identified with more approach activities versus avoidance activities with their response to the dissonant leaders, and more positive emotional regions of the brain, or regions of the brain were activated that are associated with more positive emotions, were shown in response to the resonant leaders, more negative emotional regions of the brain in response to the dissonant leaders. So we have not just a body of psychological and behavioral evidence now, we also are beginning to understand what goes on in the brain at very fast speeds, predominantly unconsciously. Now, just to give you an illustration, I'm about to show you a slide of the activation of the inferior frontal gyrus. This is a part of the default mode network, part of the social network that we were talking about. And as you can see in this slide, the orange-ish yellow area shows statistically significant activation in recalling resonant leaders, moments with resonant leaders versus moments with dissonant leaders. So all of this again brings us back to the issue that resonant leadership is common sense, but it's not common practice. And that's where the rub is. In coming modules, we'll be talking about why does that happen? Why do people lose their resonance? Why do people lose being in touch with other people around them and their environment? But before we do that, I would like to identify the personal learning assignment coming out of this week's modules. What I'd like you to do over the next week, at least, is to every situation in which you're at a meeting, at school or at work, in which there is somebody in a leadership position. You're at work and there's a project leader, there's a manager holding a staff meeting or some executive. If you're in school, a teacher or somebody in a sports team or club, the chairperson or the head of the team holding a meeting. I want you to make observations, keep some notes, and please write them in your personal journal about what were they doing or saying that you think made you and the other people in the room feel or experience more hope, more compassion, or more mindfulness? Did you feel lifted and inspired as a result of this interaction, or did you feel deflated and emptied by it? In other words, was it relatively more resonance or dissonance that you were experiencing? And it's very helpful to keep track of this for at least a week through a variety of people in different situations. And like I said, if you write it in your personal journal, and then if you will share some of your observations and thoughts about what was going on, why it happened, how frequently the resonance or dissonance was appearing, on the electronic discussions, you'll find that others are beginning to have interesting, related, if not very similar, experiences. In the process, I think this will help you reflect more on the day-to-day experiences that you're having with resonant and, unfortunately, all too often, dissonant leaders. And again, in the next module, we'll go into the details of exactly how does this occur? How do we engage our resonance or, unfortunately, how do we lose it and slide into dissonance? Thank you.